Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll give an update today on the latest COVID situation and also provide an assessment of the current course of the pandemic. First, though, today's statistics: 2,771 positive cases were reported yesterday, 12.8% of all the tests that were carried out. 779 people are currently in hospital with COVID, which is 8 more than yesterday, and 57 people are receiving intensive care, which is the same number as yesterday. Sadly, a further 17 deaths have been reported over the past 24 hours, and that takes the total number of deaths under this daily definition to 9,406. And again, I want to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. More positively, the vaccination programme continues to make very good progress. I can confirm that 4,331,574 people have received a first dose, and 3,930,317 have now had both doses. In total, 88% of all those over 18 are now fully vaccinated with two doses. In addition, 76% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 56% of 12 to 15-year-olds have had a first dose. Until now, of course, only a single dose has been recommended for these age groups, but following yesterday's updated advice from the JCVI, we're now preparing to offer second doses to 16 and 17-year-olds. I will say a bit more about the progress of the booster programme later. However, it is worth pointing out that on first, second and booster and third doses, Scotland is currently the most vaccinated part of the UK. That is down, of course, to the incredible hard work of everyone involved in organising and delivering the programme, and I want to record my thanks to each and every one of them. Today's weekly update, of course, coincides with the latest three-week review point for the remaining COVID regulations. And so I can confirm that at our meeting earlier today, the Cabinet agreed to keep the current regulations in place with no immediate changes. However, we also considered, though we have not yet reached final decisions, the possibility of future changes to the COVID certification scheme. And I will say more about that shortly as well. The numbers reported in recent days here in Scotland, which I'll come on to talk about in more detail, illustrate the need for continued precautions. So too does the challenging situation being experienced again across Europe. Several European countries are currently dealing with a sharp increase in cases. Infection rates in Germany have reached their highest level since the pandemic started. The Netherlands reintroduced some COVID measures last week. Ireland has done so today. And Austria has just introduced extremely tough restrictions on people who are not fully vaccinated. All of this is a reminder that governments everywhere are grappling with the same issues and dilemmas that we are. The threats posed by COVID are very much still with us, even though they have been mitigated by vaccination, and the race between the virus and the vaccines has not yet been won. The situation here in Scotland also bears that out. However, before I give an update on the overall trends in Scotland, I want to say a few words about the impact of recent events in Glasgow. I will reflect more generally on COP26 in a further statement to Parliament later this afternoon. However, while we can't yet draw final conclusions, I can confirm now that there is no sign so far of any significant spike in COVID cases associated with COP26. Rigorous measures were put in place to minimise the risks of transmission. For example, anyone entering the main summit site, the Blue Zone, had to provide evidence of a negative lateral flow test result. Information published earlier today by Public Health Scotland suggests that of the people officially affiliated with COP26, approximately 4 in every 1,000 tested positive for COVID through routine lateral flow testing. This contrasts with survey data for the Scottish population as a whole, which suggests that last week 12 people in every 1,000 had COVID. And in total, since the 15th of October, 291 people with COVID across Scotland reported attending a COP-related event. That includes satellite meetings and demonstrations, as well as the main summit itself. That represents less than half of 1% of all those who tested positive for COVID over the past month and reported through Test and Protect. All of this, at this stage, Presiding Officer, suggests that the mitigations that were put in place for COP were effective, and I want to put on record my thanks to delegates for their compliance and indeed to everyone who worked so hard in the run-up to and during COP26 to secure the safest possible environment. More generally across Scotland, we have seen a gradual increase in cases over the past 2 weeks, from just over 2,500 new cases a day to approximately 3,000 cases a day at this stage. It is important to note, though, that this headline figure masks some distinct variation between different age groups. For example, cases amongst under 60s increased by 14% during the past week, and much of this increase was in people under the age of 20. By contrast, cases in the over 60 age group fell over the past week by 11%. Now, this is likely to be due, at least in part, to the success of the booster programme, which of course is prioritised among the older population, and I'll say more about that shortly. The decline in cases amongst older people may also explain why, despite the overall increase in cases, the numbers in hospital with COVID have reduced slightly in recent weeks. 3 weeks ago, 917 patients were in hospital with COVID. Today, there are 779, and the number in intensive care has also fallen, although very slightly during that time, from 59 to 57. However, all of that said, the number of patients in hospital with COVID is still extremely high. If cases continue to increase, then notwithstanding the age profile, we are likely to see hospital admissions and occupancy start to rise again. In addition, the NHS is currently treating people who are in hospital for care which had to be delayed by earlier COVID countermeasures. And of course, as we go further into winter, we can expect other seasonal pressures, for example, flu, to increase. All of this means that the NHS is under extreme pressure, and we continue to work closely with health boards to address and mitigate these pressures as far as we can. The vaccination programme, of course, continues to be critical in reducing the direct health harm caused by the virus. I mentioned a moment ago that the decline in COVID rates in older age groups and the fall in hospital admissions may well reflect the impact of the vaccine booster campaign. I can confirm that more than 1 million booster jabs have now been administered, and over 70% of the over 70 age group have now had a booster. We know that a booster jab significantly increases the effectiveness of the vaccine, so this high level of uptake is extremely important, and we will continue to push it up as far as possible. The programme took a further step forward yesterday with the launch of the online booking portal. Everyone aged 50 to 59, together with unpaid carers and household contacts of the immunosuppressed, and anyone eligible for a vaccine who's not yet had an appointment, can now book online at NHS Inform. Since yesterday morning, more than 54,000 people have made online bookings, and more than 8,000 people have made bookings through the National Helpline, which can be called on 0800 0300 8013. That's 0800 030 8013. It is, of course, important to remember that boosters can only be given 24 weeks after someone's second jab. Therefore, for many in the 50 to 59 age group, appointments will only be possible from December onwards. It's also worth pointing out that people living in Orkney, Shetland, the Western Isles and the NHS Highland Health Board areas will not use the online booking system, but instead receive information direct from their health board about local appointment arrangements. As I mentioned earlier, the JCVI updated its advice yesterday. In addition to recommending second doses for 16 and 17-year-olds, it also recommended booster jabs for people in their 40s. I very much welcome this, and the Scottish Government will now move to implement this new advice as quickly as we can. And we continue to work with health boards to ensure that the overall programme is delivered as rapidly as possible. However, it is worth taking stock of the situation as of now. This winter vaccination programme is the largest and the most complex ever undertaken in Scotland. However, since the first week in September, more than 3 million flu and booster jabs have been administered. Take-up rates have been encouraging, and this is providing vital protection as we head into winter. So once again, I'm hugely grateful to everyone helping get jabs into people's arms as quickly as possible. And I also want to take this opportunity again to urge every single person who is eligible for vaccination, whether for a first or second jab or a booster or third jab, to please take up the offer without delay and get the flu jab too if you are eligible. Getting vaccinated remains the single most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves, our loved ones and our communities. It is impossible to overstate how important it is to get vaccinated, so if you haven't already, please do so now. You could be saving your own life or the lives of your loved ones. You will be reassuring others, including those most at risk, some of whom have clinical conditions that mean they cannot get vaccinated themselves. You will be helping those working in the NHS, and you will be maximising our collective chances of getting through this winter without the need to reintroduce any restrictions. Presiding Officer, in my view, choosing without good reason not to be vaccinated is deeply irresponsible. Getting vaccinated, on the other hand, is a civic duty, and it is the most precious gift we can give to others at this time. The vaccine programme is and will continue to be the bedrock of our efforts to control COVID. However, other baseline mitigations remain in place, and they are also important. Lateral flow testing, as I mentioned earlier, appears to have been effective in limiting transmission during COP. That should remind all of us that these tests are a really important way of detecting infection, particularly in those without symptoms, and therefore preventing onward spread. So I would again encourage everyone to do a lateral flow test at least twice a week, and especially if you are attending events or mixing with people in other households. The tests can be ordered free through NHS Inform or collected from test sites and local pharmacies. Face coverings also continue to be a simple but important mitigation and remain a legal requirement on public transport, in shops and when moving around in hospitality settings. Please also continue to work from home when that is practical. I'm today asking all employers to look again at whether more workers could be supported to do more work from home over the winter period. Lastly, good ventilation is vital. If any of us are having people visit our homes, we should open a window even slightly to let some air flow through the room. Within the public sector, we've taken significant steps to improve ventilation, for example, funding for carbon dioxide monitors in schools. And in September, we announced the establishment of a £25 million fund to help businesses improve ventilation. This fund opens for applications next week. Businesses such as restaurants, bars and gyms will be able to claim back costs of up to £2,500 for measures like the installation of carbon dioxide monitors or improvements to windows and vents. More information on eligibility has been published today on the Find Business Support website. All of these basic mitigation measures are really important at this stage, but of course some of them are also valuable long-term investments. For example, better ventilation won't just reduce the spread of COVID, it will also help reduce the spread of other airborne viruses now and in the future. And there's an important point here which is worth stressing. When we talk, as many do these days, about living with COVID, it's important that we don't think of this as simply giving in to the virus. Instead, it is about making sensible changes that allow us to return both to greater normality and to better health. Presiding Officer, the final mitigation measure I want to talk about today is the COVID certification scheme. It is the strong view of the Scottish Government that this, together with the other measures still in place, makes an important and proportionate contribution to stemming COVID transmission. The value of certification is also recognised in other countries, many of which require certification for access to a much wider range of services than is currently the case in Scotland. Wales, for example, expanded the scope of its own scheme yesterday. It now applies to theatres, cinemas and concert halls, in addition to the same range of venues as in Scotland. The Cabinet discussed possible changes to the current certification scheme at our meeting this morning. We intend to take a final decision next Tuesday in light of the most up-to-date data. In the meantime, later this week, we will publish an evidence paper and consult businesses on the practicalities of implementation should any changes be made. However, while final decisions have not yet been reached, I want to provide an update on the issues under consideration. I should also say that we would provisionally intend for any changes we do decide to make to the scheme to take effect from December the 6th. When the scheme launched on 1st October, we judged that it was not appropriate at that time, given the imperative to drive up vaccination rates, to include testing as an alternative to proof of vaccination, but we indicated this would be kept under review. So we will be assessing in the coming days whether, on the basis of current and projected vaccination uptake rates, we are now in a position to amend the scheme so that in addition to showing evidence of vaccination to access a venue, there will also be the option of providing evidence of a recent negative test result. That is already a feature, of course, of many other countries' certification schemes. We're also considering whether an expansion of the scheme to cover more settings would be justified and prudent, given the current state of the pandemic. Again, let me stress that we have not at this stage taken a decision to extend the reach of the scheme. However, to allow us to engage openly with businesses in the coming days about the pros, cons and practicalities, I can confirm that the kinds of settings that might be in scope would be indoor cinemas, theatres and some other licensed and hospitality premises. We would, of course, retain exemptions for those under 18, for those who cannot be vaccinated or tested for medical reasons, for people on clinical trials and for those who work at events or in venues subject to the scheme. Exceptions would also be retained for worship, weddings, funerals and related gatherings. I will give a further update on this in next week's statement, and if we decide to propose any amendments to the regulations on certification, Parliament will have the opportunity to discuss and debate these amendments. Presiding Officer, I am acutely aware that many businesses want us to remove mitigations, including certification, not extend or tighten them. I understand that, but all of our decisions are and must be motivated by a desire to keep people safe, but also to get through what will be a challenging winter without having to reintroduce any restrictions on trade. We want, if possible, businesses to stay fully open over Christmas and through the winter, while also keeping COVID under control. If an expansion of COVID certification can help us do that, it would be irresponsible not to consider it. Presiding Officer, as the detail of this statement makes clear, and as the situation across Europe also shows, the need to carefully manage this pandemic still deprives us of any easy options. While we hope very much to get through winter without reintroducing any further restrictions, as some other countries are now starting to do, we do have a duty to keep proportionate options under review, and we will do so. To assist with and give an insight into the factors guiding our considerations, we are also publishing an updated strategic framework today. This covers in more detail many of the issues I have already summarised. And one of the points it reiterates is that all of us across society, individuals, businesses and other organisations, must continue to play our part in helping curb the spread of the virus. For that reason, Cabinet Secretaries are continuing to work with COSLA, individual local authorities and businesses on the actions we need to take to reduce transmission, preferably without additional restrictions. And I will close again by reiterating what we can all do to protect ourselves and each other. So firstly, please do get vaccinated if you're eligible and haven't yet done so. As I mentioned earlier, that includes going for a booster jab when you're invited. It is never too late to get vaccinated, and it remains the single most important thing any of us can do right now. Second, please test regularly with lateral flow devices. These, of course, can be ordered through NHS Inform or collected from local test sites or pharmacies. If you test positive or are identified as a close contact or have symptoms of the virus, please self-isolate and book a PCR test. And third, please comply with the mitigation still in place. Work from home when that is possible. Wear face coverings in indoor public places, shops, public transport and moving around in hospitality. Wash hands and surfaces thoroughly. And meet outdoors if that is possible. That obviously gets harder through the winter, but it is the case that outdoor environments are safer than indoors. And when you are meeting indoors, try to open windows. Anything to improve ventilation will help. All of these precautions do still make a difference. They will protect us and those around us, and they will help to ease the burden on our NHS. So I ask everyone to continue to stick with them and thank everyone for doing so.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's vital that everyone who can have a COVID jag goes out and gets it as soon as possible. The vaccine, including the booster jag, is our best weapon against this virus. And that's why we've called for the reopening of mass vaccination centres. This will ensure that, alongside the current local delivery programme, we maximise the opportunities for people to get their vaccine booster. So will the First Minister agree to reopen these mass vaccination centres so we can speed up the booster jab rollout and help to protect people quicker? Today, the public were expecting a statement that delivered clear decisions. We all were. That was the message the Deputy First Minister was sent out to give this Parliament last week. Instead, we're being told once more to wait until next week. The government has delayed again, creating wholly avoidable uncertainty. Businesses are once again being left in the dark and treated as an afterthought. They might have less than 2 weeks to adapt to changes to the vaccine passport scheme at one of the busiest times of the year for the hospitality industry. And this has a big impact on their staff as well. It is a total lack of respect for Scottish businesses who the SNP expect to shoulder the costs of their vaccine passport scheme. The Deputy First Minister said last Tuesday that this government would discuss options with businesses over the course of this week. So can the First Minister give a clear answer and tell us the outcome of those discussions over the last week? The government must know who might be impacted. So let me ask the First Minister the same question I asked the Deputy First Minister last week. Exactly which businesses are the government still considering expanding the vaccine passport scheme to? Because she mentioned, and I quote, some other hospitality venues. Which hospitality venues have to prepare for this added burden? And finally, the First Minister has just said, and I quote, we want, if possible, businesses to stay fully open over Christmas. We know the government wants to keep options open, but will the First Minister be clear to Scottish businesses and the jobs that depend on them? Does that statement mean the SNP government are considering closing businesses and premises over the winter months?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, it pains me to say this, but the immaturity and irresponsibility of Douglas Ross in the face of this virus continues to be utterly breathtaking. Is he, I know he's had other things in his mind in recent days, but is he oblivious to what is currently happening across Europe, where this virus is on the rise again and governments everywhere are once again having to grapple with the most difficult decisions? We are seeking to do that in a responsible way. That's what we have done throughout, and we will continue to do that in the period ahead. Two issues were raised in particular, one on vaccination. We are organising the vaccination programme in this phase in the way that makes best use of resources and vaccinates people as quickly as possible. One of the things I've learned in recent weeks is whatever we decide to do, Douglas Ross will probably oppose it. So when we introduce a vaccination programme for younger teenagers that wasn't principally school-based, that was criticised, but then it turned out we managed to vaccinate those younger teenagers quicker than any other part of the UK. Across every single dose of this vaccine right now, Scotland is the most vaccinated part of the UK. We are not complacent about that. We continue to press to speed this up every single day. But this vaccination programme is going extremely well, and perhaps once in a while, Douglas Ross could find it within himself to thank those who are working so hard across the country to make sure people are vaccinated. And on the issue of COVID certification, it's simply not an option right now for any government across Europe or much of the world to do nothing in the face of this virus. The easiest thing, of course, is to oppose everything that governments decide to do to try to keep people safe. If I had Douglas Ross bemoans the fact that Cabinet hasn't taken a final decision yet. If I had stood up here today and said we had taken a final decision to expand the reach of the certification scheme, he would have criticised that, of course, and said that we were acting too quickly, that we weren't taking account of the up-to-date data. We have decided to consider this carefully, to take account of the up-to-date data and reach a decision next week. In the meantime, we will publish an evidence paper and we will consult with businesses on the practicalities and the pros and cons. And we will decide which businesses on the basis of the data and the evidence. I've set out today, in order to give people an update on what we're considering, the sectors that we are considering. And people only have to look around at the UK, Wales right now, Ireland, which is extending its COVID certification and many countries across Europe to see that actually most governments are grappling with these same difficult decisions. The easiest thing in the world right now, as Douglas Ross has found out, is to oppose everything. But when you have a duty, as government does, to try to keep people safe, then the decisions are harder than that, and we will continue to take them with an intense degree of responsibility.
Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to start by offering my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one and to recognise those who continue to put every effort into the front line and keep us all safe. I would urge the government, though, to do more than just applaud them and thank them. Recognise and reward them too when they come forward with their own pay disputes. The government has still not fixed the tools they already have and are now instead looking at expanding a system that the Deputy First Minister himself said he had no evidence that it was reducing cases of COVID. The vaccine works. It reduces hospitalisations, it reduces death rates, it reduces cases of long COVID. But it does not stop you from getting the virus and it doesn't stop you from spreading the virus. The First Minister in her statement said that lateral flow testing helped to reduce transmission at COP. She has been arguing the opposite in relation to the vaccine passport scheme. At every point in the process of developing vaccine passports, we have argued the importance of a negative test. In fact, every single scheme that the First Minister quoted in her statement and in her response includes the use of a negative test. So in the coming week, accept you got it wrong, admit that testing should always have been at the heart of our COVID reduction strategy, and commit today to including a negative test in any reformed or expanded scheme, to meaningfully engage with the sectors impacted, to share the evidence, to consider the practicalities and provide a financial packages that stop businesses going under and people losing their jobs.
First Minister.
Firstly, reward for those who work so hard in our National Health Service. I would dearly love to be in a position to give a higher pay rise than we have, and we will always seek to maximise that. But I do think it's important to put on record that NHS workers in Scotland, Agenda for Change workers, are receiving this year the highest pay increase of any NHS workers in any part of the UK, including where Labour is in government. So perhaps we should judge on what they do, not just on what they say. On the issue of the vaccine certification scheme and the inclusion of a negative test, this is a finely balanced judgment. When we have take a decision to introduce a scheme with the express objective of using that, at least in part, to drive up vaccination rates, it makes no sense to have an alternative to vaccine initially as part of that scheme, because then we wouldn't have seen. There is perhaps an argument here that one of the reasons why we are currently the most vaccinated part of the UK is that, at least in part, our vaccine certification scheme has helped to drive vaccine uptake. Now, there comes a point where your consideration changes because you make a judgment that we have already got all of the gains of increased vaccine uptake and therefore we can move to include LFD tests. I understand the importance of LFD tests as part of a package of measures. That's why every week when I stand here, I talk about the importance of them. These are careful judgments to take. We have taken careful judgments up until now. We will not always get these judgments right, but we will continue to take them responsibly and taking account of all of the evidence. We will, as I said in my statement, publish an evidence paper this week. We will continue to talk to businesses and we will continue to arrive at these very difficult decisions as carefully as we possibly can. I know that for the opposition here, they want to say that we just need to do nothing and everything that we put forward is opposed. That is an easy option. But when you're in government, there are no easy options, particularly in the face of a global pandemic.
Alex Cole Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, if any proof were needed that vaccine certification is unnecessary and there are better alternatives, then it can be found at COP26. The First Minister just said herself that it was the safest possible environment. With using daily LFTs, attendees were three times less likely to test positive for COVID-19 than the general population where vaccine certification is at large. We know that LFTs are superior to vaccine passports in two significant ways. Firstly, they provide an on-the-day snapshot of your COVID status rather than your vaccine status, which helps venues ascertain who is sick and who is well. And secondly, perhaps most importantly, it prevents the need for you to pass part of your medical history or evidence of recent treatment to somebody who is not your clinician. A mixed bag or a combination of these two schemes will not cut it. So will the First Minister abandon vaccine certification entirely and build a scheme built entirely around lateral flow testing? Thank you.
First Minister.
Oh, I won't, because I think my duty to try to keep the population of Scotland as safe as possible means that I can't just take the easy options that Alec Hamilton might put forward. And I think he misunderstands the package of mitigations that were in place around COP26, where part of the protections were that delegates were asked to be double vaccinated before they arrived. We offered vaccination to people who were coming from countries where that wasn't available. And then LFD tests, of course, were an additional precaution over and above that. So it's easy to be selective, but it is perhaps better to look at the whole package of measures that were in place. And in terms of the wider issue here, when you have a scheme that is partly about driving up vaccination rates, then it makes no sense to give an alternative to vaccine because then you undermine the objective of your scheme. And it is really important. Vaccines have limitations, although they are hugely effective. LFD tests are effective, but also have limitations. We need to use all of these tools at our disposal to drive rates down as far as possible and keep people as safe as possible. And that's the obligation and the responsibility that this government will continue to take seriously, even when it means unpopular decisions every single day that we're in this pandemic.
Annabel Ewing, to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A significant continuing impact of the COVID pandemic has been the restriction on face-to-face meetings with GPs, which is impacting on people across my Cowdenbeath constituency and indeed across Scotland. Can the First Minister therefore advise as to what steps are being taken to improve patient access to GPs, and whether the need for the current 2-metre infection control requirement in healthcare settings will be kept under review?
First Minister.
Well, our recovery plan includes working with GPs to restore face-to-face consultations in surgeries. Public Health Scotland has already published updated guidance for primary care settings, covering key issues like physical distancing, which is now 1 metre, not 2, access for patients and wider infection prevention and control, and this will be kept under review. We aspire to return to a greater availability of face-to-face appointments. However, a number of patients will wish to continue with phone or video consultations. Where clinically necessary, the option to have a face-to-face consultation should always be available. Our winter funding package will help increase NHS and social care capacity over the winter, and that of course includes funding for accelerated recruitment to aid general practice.
Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister in her statement recognised the very substantial concern that already exists in the business community about any extension of the vaccine passport scheme, when some hospitality businesses are already reporting a 40% loss of trade. Now other businesses could face a similar loss of trade and additional costs in providing extra staffing with just 2 weeks to prepare for changes. If the Scottish Government goes down this route, will it provide a package of additional financial support for those businesses which are affected, because it is already badly required?
First Minister.
We'll continue to consider additional financial support as necessary. In fact, on a different issue today, I've just announced or confirmed additional financial support to enable businesses, including bars and restaurants, to improve ventilation. So we will continue to look very favourably at any argument that is made there. I think Murdo Fraser and others have to be very careful with this argument that because trade is down, that is an argument against measures to make settings safer. I've spoken to many people, and I appreciate this will not be a unanimous view, but I've spoken to many people anecdotally who say that the reason they're not going back to pubs and restaurants is because they don't yet feel safe enough, and that actually if people's vaccine records were being checked, that would make them feel safer and perhaps more likely to go back. So there are arguments in both directions on this. I understand how difficult it is for hospitality, for the tourism trade and for other sectors that have been so badly affected. But the key to getting back to normal is to firstly keep COVID under control and then build the confidence of people to start going back to normal life. And we've got to use every possible tool at our disposal to do that.
Eleanor Whittam, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
I've had a number of constituents contact me to raise their concerns about the lack of access to general dental practitioners for all but emergency treatment, and that such treatment is often framed around minimum interventions. There have also been issues with people moving to Kirkcaldy and Doon Valley and not being able to register with a dentist. Can the First Minister advise when general dental practices will resume more routine services?
First Minister.
From, I think, early November last year, when the full range of care and treatment was made available, we've been working to increase patient access in NHS dentistry. That has included additional funding for ventilation and improved dental drills, for example. We're in discussion with the BDA to support dentists and put patients at the centre of building a sustainable NHS service. And from February next year, we'll bring in enhanced fees for a range of treatments, including a more comprehensive examination, supporting NHS dental teams to clear the backlog in routine care that built up during the course of the pandemic. We've already provided £50 million of financial support, plus an additional £35 million of PPE to ensure that dental services can emerge well-placed to care for patients across Scotland.
Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A constituent contacted me after the instructions with the lateral flow test kit advised her to record the results through an NHS Scotland website. The UK government website sends confirmation of a result within minutes. My constituent discovered that the Scottish website can take up to 24 hours. This is useless when confirmation is required the same day as the test in order to visit loved ones in a care home. Can I ask the First Minister why the wait times for the Scottish website are so long, and whether there is a need for a separate Scottish system when the UK government system works?
First Minister.
I'm genuinely more than happy to look into that in a bit more detail. The advice is for people doing LFD tests to record the result of those tests through the UK website. I've been doing that myself every day for the past couple of weeks and do it regularly. So that is the advice. So I'm not entirely clear exactly what website is being referred to, but if the details can be passed to me, I'm happy to look into that and provide any further information and advice after I've had the opportunity to do so.
Julian Martin, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Aberdeenshire's COVID cases are some of the highest in Scotland at the moment. I'd like to ask the First Minister what government support has been given to the local authority and health and social care partnership as they try to mitigate any staff absences in schools, nurseries, care facilities, and ensure the continued delivery of public services.
First Minister.
Well, I certainly recognise the impact of the current situation in Aberdeenshire and indeed other areas. We have made significant resources available to local authorities specifically for challenges like those narrated by Gillian Martin. In schools, for example, we've provided local government with more than £200 million of additional funding over the past 2 years, specifically for the recruitment of more school staff to support education recovery. Aberdeenshire has received around £12 million of this funding, and our guidance for both schools and early learning centres, including at-home asymptomatic testing, is contributing to keeping transmission rates among staff low. In all settings, though, adherence to mitigations does make a difference, and everyone has a part to play in continuing to minimise transmission.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Several constituents continue to contact me about confusion around the booster rollout in mainland Argyll and Bute, which comes under NHS Highland. People have received letters inviting them to attend vaccination centres that are either nowhere near them or don't exist at all, leading to considerable distress, particularly for older and vulnerable people who are unsure as to where and when they will receive their booster. Given the importance of the vaccine booster campaign, will the government act immediately to sort this out?
First Minister.
I know officials have been talking to Argyll and Bute just in the last day or so to resolve some of the issues that are being experienced. I'll ask the Health Secretary to write to the member with an update following those discussions.
Joe Fitzpatrick, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Can I ask the First Minister to provide an assurance that should it be deemed necessary to introduce further measures such as an extension of mitigations or vaccine certification to avoid the kinds of restrictions seen in Austria and the Netherlands, that this will be done with as much notice as possible, with guidance for venues to support the implementation and continued engagement with affected sectors to understand the impact of any changes?
First Minister.
Not with her. He's a charmer. Is the leader of the opposition. Presiding officer, The answer is yes, we will continue to discuss with individuals, with businesses, with other sectors, the very difficult options that will lie ahead of us if we continue to see COVID cases rise over the winter period. We are seeing across Europe right now, we're seeing in parts of the British Isles right now, the emergence of another very challenging situation. And the lesson, one of the lessons we have learned throughout this pandemic, is that often we have to take very unpalatable decisions in order to stop a situation deteriorating. But the earlier we act around increasing compliance, for example, with the basic mitigations in place, doing things like improving ventilation, the more chance we have of avoiding some of the measures that we're seeing in countries like the Netherlands, Austria, and even today in Ireland, much closer to home. So what I would say, because this has worked in the previous peaks we've experienced in recent weeks, if we all step up our compliance with basic mitigations, if we all recognise the importance, the vital importance of vaccination and get vaccinated as soon as we're able to do so, then I hope we will be able to get through winter without having to reimpose any further restrictions. That is the aim of the government, but no responsible government, absolutely no responsible government can stand here in the face of a pandemic as we go into another winter and give empty promises on what might or might not be possible. Our duty, our solemn duty, is to act in a way, however unpopular it might be, to keep the country as safe as possible, and that is what we will continue to seek to do.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've previously asked about flu vaccinations for those who are not prioritised for the COVID booster but are normally eligible for the flu vaccine. The NHS Inform website gives no information about how to get your flu vaccine if you're not in one of the COVID priority groups and are in an age group where the JCVI has not approved a booster. Can the First Minister lay out how those who are susceptible to flu can get their vaccine?
First Minister.
It is possible to book a flu vaccine, as I understand. I'm going to ask the Health Secretary to write and put this in spice with the detail of exactly how to do that, because we want to make sure people fully understand that. For those who are in priority groups for the booster campaign, where possible, we are advising that they get the flu vaccine and their booster at the same time. It's better for them. It is also allows us to get through the programme even more quickly. And for those whose booster will not fall due, and I know I am in this category until later this year, the advice is it is safe to wait to get your flu vaccine at that time in order that you can get them together. Obviously, NHS Inform provides further information and advice, but for those who are not in the priority categories for the booster but are eligible for flu, and remember there is a significant overlap between the two categories of eligibility, I'll make sure that the Health Secretary provides some information for the benefit of constituents about how exactly flu vaccines, standalone flu vaccines, should be accessed.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
First Minister, I've been contacted by constituents who are past the six-month guidance date for their COVID-19 booster vaccination, and they're concerned that the efficacy of the primary vaccine dose is waning. So can I ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government has received advice from clinical advisers on the efficacy of the primary vaccine protection, and what reassurance can be given to those who are awaiting booster appointments? And I remind Chamber that I'm part of NHS D&G's vaccine team.
First Minister.
Well, the JCVI advice is that the booster vaccine should be offered no earlier than 6 months after the completion of the primary vaccine course, and that means no earlier than 6 months after the second dose that somebody has. As I think I've said in the Chamber before, the Scottish Government is interpreting that as 24 weeks. Of course, by the time that the JCVI advice was received, some people, many people, had already past that 6 months, 24-week period. So we are in a catch-up situation, but that catch-up is going well, and we continue to do that at pace. The advice from clinicians is that the immunity from the primary course doesn't suddenly fall, you know, off a cliff and end when you reach that period, but there is concern about gradual waning. So we want to get the boosters done as quickly as possible, and that is what the programme is working so hard to do and so successfully right now to do.
Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
First Minister, my constituents are having problems accessing vaccine boosters and the passport. I've been advised to tell constituents to update their address with their old vaccination centre in England in order to have their Scottish update status updated when, for instance, they have one dose in England and one in Scotland. But I've also had constituents told to follow the advice for foreign vaccinations if they've been vaccinated in Northern Ireland. And I've also had constituents who've been fully vaccinated in other parts of the UK, but NHS Scotland doesn't hold the details and now they can't get their booster vaccines. So could the First Minister say what the Scottish Government is doing to try and fix what's a really opaque and confusing system for many of our constituents?
First Minister.
I'm happy to do that. I will ensure that the Health Secretary writes to the member. This is entirely my fault, but I wasn't sure I was following all of the particular examples that were being put to me there. It is really important that people understand what to do in all of these circumstances where they've had one dose in England, another in Scotland, or where they're having their booster somewhere else. But to make sure that we give very clear information on what people should do, there is a portal, of course, where people can update their vaccine certification, but in order to make sure that I'm answering that question properly and in full detail, I'll do it in written form. And again, as I said in a previous answer, put the information in SPICE as well.
Siobhan Brown, to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. All medical advice has indicated that the transmission rate, including the number of people unfortunately in hospital at the moment, is higher amongst those who have yet to receive the vaccine. As we head into the winter months, can the First Minister elaborate on some of the concerns that clinical advisers have on the pressures facing the NHS if this trend continues the way it is?
First Minister.
This is a really important factor in all of our considerations. The NHS, as we all know, is working under extreme pressure right now, possibly the most extreme pressure that the NHS has ever faced in its entire history. Much of that pressure does come from COVID. However, the NHS is also working to catch up on the backlog of care caused by earlier restrictions. So the combination of events, and that is before we are properly into a possible flu season, means that we are likely to see significant pressure on the NHS over the whole of this winter period. What we do know is that the more COVID cases there are, the greater that pressure will be. People who are not vaccinated are at greater risk of getting the virus and becoming seriously ill from the virus. So one of the things all of us can do to try to reduce the pressure on the NHS is to get vaccinated if we haven't already with our first and second dose, and certainly when we're able to with our booster dose. If we see cases rise as we are gradually at the moment, then notwithstanding the variation in the age profile there, we are going to see hospitalisations increase as well. And at a time when the pressure on the NHS is already so acute, that obviously would be a seriously concerning development. So vaccination is one of the things all of us can do to try to ease that pressure as much as possible.
Tess White, to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, the updated COVID strategic framework emphasises the importance of testing and anticipates a significantly increased demand on testing capacity this winter. Can the Scottish Government provide assurances that sufficient testing resources are in place to meet demand over the coming months?
First Minister.
Yes, I can. We work hard every day to show that the capacity is there. We also work with the UK Government, given that much of our testing capacity, not all of it, but much of our testing capacity is delivered through the Four Nations Lighthouse programme. So these are issues that get attention, very close attention, from the Health Secretary, from I and from the Government as a whole every single day.
Stephanie Callaghan, to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether autism is classed as a neurodisability, and if so, will young people in the spectrum aged between 12 and 16 years old be invited for a second vaccination?
First Minister.
The JCVI have already advised that children and young people aged 12 to 17 who are at an increased risk of severe COVID infection should receive a full course of vaccination, and that means two doses. Eligibility does cover severe neuro disabilities, which does include autism, and vaccination is already being offered to this cohort.
Finlay Carson, to be followed by Jenny Minto.
Presently, a COVID booster vaccination record is not available to those who wish to travel to certain countries, which have recently imposed a 270-day limit on post-second vaccination. This in effect means that those who have received both vaccinations by spring 2021 will be denied entry to those countries despite having had the third vaccination. It's my understanding that currently NHS Scotland cannot provide evidence of a third vaccination, and this is becoming increasingly important for international travel. If this is the case, will the First Minister commit to resolving the issue as a matter of urgency?
First Minister.
Unless I'm wrong here, in which case I'm sure this will be pointed out, I think the position in Scotland is the same as it is in other parts of the UK right now. We are currently looking at how we incorporate booster vaccinations into the app and the vaccine certificate. Indeed, it's an issue we discussed at Cabinet this morning. So steps will be taken to ensure, particularly for international travel, where we are dependent, of course, on the requirements of other countries, that people are not disadvantaged and that the benefits of booster vaccines are properly reflected.
Jenny Minto, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following on from that question, I've been contacted by a constituent who will soon be travelling to Austria, and to do so, they require proof of their vaccination or booster vaccination within 9 months before entry. So could the First Minister expand on COVID boosters being recorded on vaccination status records and the NHS Scotland app?
First Minister.
Well, as I said in response to the previous question, we are committed to adding boosters to vaccine certificates, and we are considering right now the steps to be taken to do that. One additional piece of information that I think it is important to point out to the Chamber, that currently there is no international standard on how to display booster information on vaccine certificates, so there is still work underway to develop the appropriate systems to meet these requirements. Until we do have an international standard, there will be no guarantee that any solution will be accepted in all other countries. So it's really important that we do this in the proper way, and of course, in the interim, any individual looking to travel should check what is needed for entry into the country they are visiting. We will provide updates on progress with the incorporation of booster vaccines regularly and as soon as possible.
Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 8th of November, the Scottish Government confirmed that as of the 15th of October, 40,768 ventilation inspections had taken place across learning, teaching and play spaces. The First Minister has rightly confirmed the importance of ventilation. So can I ask the First Minister, how many of those spaces failed the inspection under the government criteria, and what does the First Minister expect to happen to those spaces that failed?
First Minister.
Of course, we've provided funding for local authorities to inspect and assess the quality of ventilation and then to take any follow-up steps. I'll happily come back to the member on the detail to the extent that we have it, because this is information held by local authorities around the outcome of assessments, but making sure that these assessments are done. That's why we provided funding for carbon dioxide monitors, and I know all local authorities have taken that very seriously to improve the quality of ventilation in schools and early learning centres.
Karen Adam, to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. People have recently expressed their frustration at seeing the Prime Minister with no mask on in a hospital, some who have loved ones in hospital with COVID. Can I ask the First Minister, what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that people will understand the importance of adhering to guidelines regardless of vaccination status, particularly through these winter months?
First Minister.
Well, specifically, we launched yesterday the next phase of our marketing and communication programme to support compliance with the baseline measures that are still in place, including wearing face coverings to help reduce the harms caused by COVID. And what I'd say to everybody is that it is really important as we go into winter that all of us just try to increase our compliance. I understand, and you know, all of us slip up from time to time on these things. I understand how tiresome, how inconvenient it is, particularly after so long. But as we go into winter, wearing face coverings, reminding ourselves to do it is really important. And I know I'll be doing that, and I would call on everybody to do likewise.
And Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister told Parliament that she would listen to businesses before introducing COVID certification. She didn't. Now she's considering extending it. This morning we learned that one in four Scottish businesses are facing immediate financial peril if COVID restrictions are expanded. This from a survey conducted of 700 businesses by the Scottish Chambers of Commerce. So will the First Minister confirm that if businesses respond with a resounding no to her creeping plans, as the Scottish Chambers of Commerce already has, calling it a giant step backwards, that she will abandon any extension to the scheme?
First Minister.
We do listen to businesses and we will continue to listen to businesses, an important voice, but not the only voice. I also have a duty to listen to those working in the front line of our National Health Service who are saying we need to do as much as we can to reduce the risk of COVID transmission. And I need to listen to people across the country who want to be able to go back to pubs and restaurants but feel safer as they do so, particularly when we've got rising rates of transmission, to those who are particularly clinically vulnerable, who also want to feel safe when they're going about their normal life. So one of the difficult things, but I accept it as part of the responsibility of taking decisions as opposed to just deciding on a position and sticking to it, is that we have to take account of and listen to a range of views and come to a balanced, sensible and responsible decision. Businesses are an important voice in that, but actually we have to take account of the wide range of considerations and factors that lead to us taking decisions in what is an inherently difficult and complex set of circumstances.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This morning, a concerned constituent whose daughter has COVID contacted me about a potential flaw in the Scottish contact and trace system. She received a text saying, "You will be sent a link to a digital self-tracing form to list close contacts." After chasing the link, that hadn't appeared. She was then told that she may not receive the link and would be contacted by a contact tracer. This also did not happen, and my constituent called Test and Protect, who admitted there's a problem sending out the text messages with links to the contact tracing forms. First Minister, would you agree that this is a dangerous shambles and must be urgently addressed?
First Minister.
No, I don't agree. In fact, I think that is an insult to all those working so hard in Test and Protect across our country. I am happy to look at the individual case. It certainly sounds there as if something has happened that shouldn't have happened, and if that is in any way indicative of a more systemic issue, we will take that on board and seek to address that. So if the member can send me the details. But people across Test and Protect are working really hard every single day right now, and the contribution of Test and Protect to helping us keep COVID at this stage under some control is enormous. And let me just end this answer by placing on record again my grateful appreciation for all that they're doing.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. There'll be a brief delay before the next item of business.